Hello everyone, Lonsay Mackinus here, coming at you from, well, within my own little apartment here in Natchitoches, Louisiana. Okay, so, I was on a stream with, I was actually in the chat with Ultimate Admiral's Dreadnought with Spartan Elite 43, and one of the other commenters, MoonSavager, requested a video on how to make the lore. Spartan and all the others on the chat seem to like the lore that I write. So Spartan, of course, I guess he gets a big joy out of reading what I write on the chat. So I figured I would go ahead and put a video up showing exactly how to make lore. It's really not that difficult when you get down to it. You just need to be able to string certain parts together. For instance, let me shut that off. You don't need to see my TV or nothing like that. Not that I'd put it on YouTube anyway. But anyway, basically, for example, with Spartan's Ultimate Admiral's Dreadnought's stream, as I'm watching along, if he gets into, you know, the battles and whatnot, the battles, of course, are action-packed. You've got multiple ships from the enemy side and allied side fighting it out. Essentially, you watch the video, you enjoy it, of course, but you look for certain things, like, for instance, here we go. My notepad. I always keep it beside me whenever I'm on the computer, and whenever I'm doing a stream, because I put not only my notes for my own personal fan fictions that I post on fanfiction.net, which is another site that I frequent. I also, and of course, DeviantArt, of course. I also write down lore and stories for, you know, the streams I see, if they seem interesting. Like, I didn't actually do this at first, but as you know, I got hooked into Spartan's Ultimate Admiral's Dreadnought stream back when he was still doing the Germans' long campaign. old force of habit. Anyway, so I got hooked into the stream, and I started writing little bitty notes for it. Like, I might have it in another notebook or something. I might have it in another notebook or something. No, wait a minute. Here we are. Remember this one? Let me go ahead and read this. During engagement with the French, light cruiser CL-2178 distinguished itself by engaging an enemy battle cruiser that was escorting a convoy of vital supplies to France. Destroyer Zarkun, on blockade duty, first detected the force and sent word to nearby forces, and 2178 was closest to respond. There was a somber atmosphere in the Admiralty when the new destroyer plans were There was a somber atmosphere in the Admiralty when the new destroyer plans were unveiled. At long last, the venerable Zarkun destroyers, which had been born as part of Project X to avenge the now lost J-class destroyers, were now obsolete and being replaced. Within 5 months, the Zarkun, which the financial section had deemed both too expensive and outdated to be refit, would be replaced with the newer Decca-class destroyers. However, the crews of the Zarkun knew something. It was only a matter of time before war was declared again. and if called to action, Zarkoon would make sure. The crew of the Zarkoon class destroyers would make sure that they would go out in a blaze of glory. You remember that one from the Germany Long campaign? Basically, it's not really that difficult, but if you're trying to write it as a story, it is kind of difficult, but if you're just writing it, so basically, rule one, have fun. Have fun with what you're doing. Make sure it's a subject that you're interested in, that appeals to you, and if you see that if it's taking, like, quite a while, like, for instance, let me turn the page on here to something more recent. This was actually something I wrote actually at the start of Spartan's stream just a while ago, back when he was still designing the ships. I had intended to write it when he actually did start the long campaign for America, for the United States, every time Ultimate Admiral's Dreadnoughts has an update, all the save files get erased or lost. So he had to start again with a brand new save file. Heck, I've had to do it multiple times already. But, for instance, if you know the time period you're in, so the campaign starts in about 1890s, leads into the building of the Dreadnoughts. This is actually in world events, if you're a history buff like I am, this is about 30 years after the events of the Civil War. 28 technically if you're countering with ironclads like the Battle of Hampton Roads with the CSS Virginia and the USS Monitor. The United States was technically still reeling from the effects of the Civil War. The Battle of Hampton Roads, the first time ironclad warships had gone to war with each other, completely turned naval doctrine on its head. For so long, tall ships with masts and sails and broadside cannons had been considered the norm. But this one battle turned everything upside down. The entire navy of multiple nations was rendered obsolete in one day. Just as when England unveiled HMS Dreadnought at the turn of the 1900s, Germany had almost caught up to Britain in terms of pre-dreadnoughts and ironclads. But with the unveiling of Dreadnought, it rendered the entire German navy obsolete overnight. There are occurrences that something like this happens. And when it does, it can have world-changing consequences. For instance, here's, like I said, this is the prologue I wrote for, you know, Spartan's Ultimate Admiral's American stream. I'm going to read it now in my own words and you'll see what I mean. The age of sail has passed. Now the industrial age, which had ruled much of the 1800s, is slowly giving way to the modern age. Tall masted sailing ships of the line, once so prominent on the high seas, are being replaced by massive steel-clad behemoths. These ships of the new navy have an insatiable appetite for coal, a heartbeat of steam, and belch thick black clouds of smoke into the sky. Gone are the days of gold-plated, beautiful wooden ships. Now come more utilitarian navies, steel ships which can deflect shells, black coloring, dark paints, which make it difficult to distinguish on the high seas. Firepower, armor, speed. Sorry, I got a little bit off topic. Writing what I wanted to say, but 200 character limit. Go figure. While the world carries on, the United States, still reeling from the effects of the Civil War, has yet to become a power that can influence world politics. This is actually historically accurate, in a way, the Civil War was the 1860s. So, by the 1890s, a lot of Civil War veterans were still alive. Some Civil War veterans were still alive. They were old men, but they were still alive. And they were telling their kids and their grandkids about what they did in the war, what side they fought on, North or South, it didn't matter. They were Americans. But I'm not discussing North or South politics or anything like that. This is a video of how to narrate or how to string together some lore. Which comes to the second part. The first part was have fun. Have fun with what you do. Rule two, find a subject. Find a subject. And if it performs to your expectations, roll with it. For instance, let's see. The majority of the subject of this stream was a little light cruiser known as the USS Gorge, which, while Spartan tended to hover over battleships the Nariko and the Robert, the cruiser Gorge, on its seemingly own initiative, of its own AI directive, engaged several enemy cruisers and scored significant hits on an enemy battleship. I'm not even gonna try and pronounce the Chinese name. I don't wanna, you know, take a risk of spelling it, of saying it wrong. But the Gorge did, light cruiser Gorge engaged the enemy cruisers, scoring significant hits on the battleship, on one battleship, a heavy cruiser, as well as engaging multiple torpedo boats, but withdrawing after a hit from a torpedo from a light cruiser. For a moment, the gorge was flooding. But thanks to the skill and daring of her crew, the flooding was stopped. That also kind of foreshadows a bit, given the eventual fate of the Gorge. But you notice I have a subject. That subject participated in the battle, and it actually did pretty good. It survived that battle. And it also wound up being the ship that delivered the coup de grace, or the final killing blow, to two cruisers and one battleship, as well as another torpedo boat or a light cruiser. Anyway, turning the page. You also have some inspiration. Like, hang on. Just turn this back on so I can actually see what I'm doing. Just a moment. Come on. There we go. All right. My computer went to sleep mode, so type in my password again. There we go. And let's see. Inspiration. Let's see. For instance, still on the subject of the gorge, there was actually a bit of inspiration from another. It was actually a bit of inspiration from another person in the chat. I think it was James who did that, who said that. I don't, but you know, the chat ain't letting me. I'm reviewing the chat as a moderator, and it's not letting me scroll up any further to see where it was. But he had the idea. He had the idea that Spartan was going on about the casualty list after the ship, after the report, and he'd let the idea that maybe when the gorge took that torpedo hit, it flooded the medical bay of the ship, this thus leading to infection running a rampant among the crew of the gorge. That could account for the fatality. So I took that idea and I rolled with it, and I acknowledged him in the chat. I acknowledged that, you know, he came up with the idea. Oh, my bad. Let's see. There we go. Still, a fleet needs supplies. Between the loss of medical supplies from Gorge's med bay, from the torpedo, and the continuous use of ammunition, this battle seems to have forced the First Fleet to withdraw. Now then, like I said, if you got an idea, roll with it. So, James's idea. So the idea was, that maybe the torpedo had hit a certain part of the ship, the gorge, and you saw how bad it was apparently flooding. She was like 50% flooded. Who's to say the medical bay hadn't gotten flooded? And as a result, medical equipment was lost. Bandages, medicines, salves, surettes, syringes, other types of medicines that may have been held in glass bottles. You never can tell what may or may not be lost when a ship floods. So the ship had lost some medical supplies. Okay, and let's see. Flip the page over, and finally, sadly, the conclusion of the gorge. Basically, you never can tell how a story's gonna end. There's gonna be twists and turns in the lore. Sometimes you just gotta roll with it. It may not be the outcome you'd like, but if you can roll with it, you can spin it into a story that people are going to like. For instance, the epilogue of the Gorge. The Chinese fleet, not to be deterred, sent another fleet to engage the First Fleet. Predictably, Gorge drew first blood, sinking two torpedo boats. Though hampered by the lack of AP shells, the captain of the Gorge ordered his gunners to engage to burn those bastards to hell as he sailed towards a group of enemy heavy cruisers. This bravado sadly spelled the end of the Gorge as she sailed into a formation of enemy light cruisers and took torpedoes and shells from all sides, eventually succumbing to her wounds. Of her entire crew, only three men were rescued. The captain and two other sailors. Enraged by the loss of the Gorge, flagship Naruko turned all of her guns on the light cruisers and destroyed them all in retaliation. You remember that incident that a lot of people talk about with the USS Wisconsin and the temper incident? Yeah, I kind of spun that in for the Noriko. Yeah, you gotta love it. In the aftermath of the battle, Gorge's captain, who, as I mentioned, had survived the sinking of his ship with two of his crew, was found at fault for the loss of the hero cruiser and was dishonorably discharged. Another cruiser, currently under construction, is to carry on. However, the U.S. Navy is not going to allow the name of the Gorge to die so easily as in the seas of the Far East. Another cruiser currently under construction in San Diego, or San Francisco, or wherever the heck Spartan decides to build it, is to carry on the name USS Gorge. Thus, you have the fall of the ship and the continuation of the line, the continuation of the name. That way you kind of leave a bit of a, even though the original Gorge may have sunk, you leave the story open-ended so that you can build the next section onto it and picture the story, if you will, like a chain. Each story is a link in that chain, and as you go on, you continue to add more and more links to that chain until eventually the chain is complete and you have a story. I really hope this is okay. You know, this is a simple enough explanation. Because to be quite honest, I've been writing for about when did I start? Back in 2000. No, further back than that. I started writing short stories in 2003. Kind of fell off that for a while, and then after graduating high school, I started writing fan fictions. I got into fanfiction.net, started writing fan fictions on that site. Of course, a lot of my projects are incomplete. I just either don't have the time or the materials or the reference work to actually string the stories together in the way that I want to. Plus, you know, I get writer's block sometimes. It happens. You just gotta try and loosen the cobwebs a little bit and try to carry on as best you can. Same thing with doing lore and whatnot. You just gotta roll with it sometimes. So, rule one, make sure to have fun doing it. Rule two, pick a subject. Rule three, follow that subject. And rule four, leave the story, you dictate the story, but you're writing about what someone else is doing. You're basically following a stream that someone else is doing, and you're adding your two bits into it. So you can't close a story. You can't close this story until the person you're narrating for says, "Okay, that's it." Leave it open-ended. That way, you can move from subject A to subject B, or continue on with the story chain, however you work it. Alrighty, so hopefully that actually, hopefully this video helps you. There we go. Yeah. All right, there we go. Okay, Moon. I know you subscribe. I saw your message that you subscribed. Thank you very much. I hope this video explains a few things about how to come up with lore, narration, and story making and such. I hope you enjoy it. And I will see you on the next video or the next time we're on a stream together in the comments. Y'all have a good night, and I will see the rest of y'all next stream.